Thank you. Jesus began to show his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem and undergo great suffering at the hands of the elders and chief priests and scribes, and be killed, and on the third day be raised. And Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him, saying, God forbid it, Lord, this must never happen to you. But he turned and said to Peter, Get behind me, Satan. You are a stumbling block to me, for you are setting your mind not on divine things, but on human things. Then Jesus told his disciples, If any want to become my followers, let them deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. For those who want to save their life will lose it, and those who lose their life for my sake will find it. For what will it profit them if they gain the whole world but forfeit their life? Or what will they give in return for their life? For the Son of Man is to come with his angels in the glory of his Father, and then he will repay everyone for what has been done. Truly I tell you, there are some standing here who will not taste death before they see the Son of Man coming in his kingdom. The Gospel of the Savior.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Miriam Edwards came to us just a few months ago to hang out with us while she is a seminarian. She is currently a postulant for Holy Orders in the Diocese of Los Angeles, and we're delighted to welcome her to our pulpit today.
In the name of the one who calls all to serve, amen.
Amen.
Good morning. Good morning. It's exciting to be here. I want to tell you a story. A story about a young girl of 13. That girl is me. And I had an amazing experience at the age of 13 that caused me, at the age of 57, to become a seminarian. I want to share my call story. It was a warm spring night, and I was sitting with rapt attention watching the miniseries Jesus of Nazareth. Some of you may remember it. I'm sure it's old as me. I was locked in my bedroom, alone, as was usually the case at this time in my life. I was a quiet, shy, introverted teen with low self-esteem. My own company was easier to handle than that of most others. As I watched, I grew more and more aware of the things that I was learning. I wouldn't call it an authoritative telling of the story of Jesus. But I still began to see his healing power, his love and care for the poor and destitute, probably for the first time in my life. It was humbling. During one of these nights of watching the miniseries, I heard a clear voice outside of me that said, "You are a priest." This was amazing and also quite puzzling. The voice was clear and it was seared in my memory. But why me? I was a girl, and women weren't even ordained in the Episcopal Church for 2 more years. Who was the sameness, and why to me? I wasn't a holy person. I did go to church with my family, but I didn't even feel that I was a good person. Priests to me at that time were special people. People with special gifts and talents. That just wasn't how I thought of myself. I continued to watch the show and put this weird event away, or so I thought. Life went on, and a couple of years after I completed college, I got married and had 2 children, Lauren and Jason. They are the loves of my life, were then and are now. But the memory of that voice kept coming back. Now it was also a deep yearning. I was still confused. I went to talk with my priest and told her about it. She got excited and wanted to start a discernment committee right away. But again, my low self-esteem got the best of me and I chickened out. Anyway, I moved away from that area and that church and just let the whole thing go. Or so I thought. Now in my 50s, My kids were quickly moving away for school and for life. I had free time on my hands, and the memory of that voice came back loud and clear. I decided to take education for ministry, or EFM, a 4-year course of study in the Old and New Testaments, church history, and theology for laity. This was another way of putting the pull of that voice away, or so I thought. It was in EFM, however, that I was introduced to theologian and prophet Howard Thurman. In his book, Jesus and the Disinherited, I read that we are all children of God. And as such, we are all worthy of the love of God. We are all worthy. That meant that I must be worthy. I had been doing some work on my self-esteem at this time, and these words from Howard Thurman sunk in. I finally could see that I was worthy. I was worthy of the call from so long ago, and worthy of the call today. I read the following in Howard Thurman's book. The awareness of being a child of God tends to stabilize the ego and result in a new courage, fearlessness, and power. I was a recipient of this newfound courage. It still took about 6 months for me to go to my priest, but the rest, as they say, is history. I have been on a path toward ordination and answering God's call ever since. So when I read today's Old Testament lesson, I couldn't help but see myself when I read about Moses. I usually don't even preach on the Old Testament, but today I must. When Moses was minding his own business, keeping his father's flock on Horeb, the mountain of God, he reacted with low self-esteem. I can relate so much to his doubts and excuses. Moses, shocked at hearing God's voice, feels unworthy to speak to God, much less for him. I think this is natural, and I think anyone who says they don't have doubts is not really being truthful. Speaking the words of God to Pharaoh, coming later in the story, seemed impossible to Moses also. Even though he would have the help of his brother Aaron, he was a lowly shepherd after all. And I still at times harbor doubts of my worthiness. I still ask God sometimes, why me? Isn't there someone else? But many people along the way have assured me that God does not call the worthy. God equips who he calls. He continues to equip me, and God equipped Moses. He gave him the words to say so that the Israelites would know he was from God. God gave Moses words to say to Pharaoh to convince him to eventually free the Israelites. And God has given me words on so many occasions. I have found myself saying the right words during interviews with the bishop and commission on ministry. That's not me, that's God. And even during my studies in seminary, the words that come to me for papers and class discussions are from the Holy Spirit. So Moses knew, and I know, that dependence on God is essential. There are other things than self-esteem issues that get in our way in answering the call from God. The things in our time that get in the way are money, power, fame, and ego, to name a few. In the gospel today, God doesn't understand Jesus and rebukes him for saying that he must die a violent death. Jesus responds with the famous words, "Get behind me, Satan." He calls Peter a stumbling block to his ministry. I wonder how that felt to Peter. Was he hurt, surprised, something else? Thinking that he was in the way of answering his call, Jesus' call from God must have really stung. But But Peter was putting his mind on earthly things, like his desire to be with Jesus always. Peter was the thing that Jesus needed to put aside to answer his call. After rebuking Peter, Jesus tells his disciples that they must give up their life to keep it. And if they don't give it up, they will lose it. This is curious and always has been puzzling to me. It means that to give up earthly concerns, to concentrate on God, is the way of keeping your life in Jesus. If we are unable to do this, we become tripped up. However, as it said today in Psalm 150, search for the Lord and his strength, continually seek his face. This will lead you in the direction of God's call. God's call is not reserved for a select few. It is not just the people who are to be ordained who are called. It is not just biblical figures who are called. Thinking this is what kept me from answering my call and kept getting in my way. But God's call is, in fact, for every one of us. If you are experiencing yearning to do something, if something has your curiosity, or if someone has told you that you would be great at something, that is a call. It is as simple as that. To answer that call is our highest privilege as Christians. It is what we are here to do. It is a call to love our neighbor. Here at St. Paul, there are many ways and many great ministries that serve God. These include Sunday Supper and the Shower Program, to name only two. These call us to love our neighbor. They are rooted in the idea that God's mission of social justice is ours as well. God calls us to ministries of social justice because God loves all people. God wants us to love all people as Jesus did. Serving one another is also loving one another and service to St. Paul's is a way to serve God. And ask the Holy Spirit would arrange it. Next week is Homecoming Sunday and the Ministry Fair. All the ministries of the church will be available to let us all know what they are doing. This is a perfect time to look at what ministries are offered here at St. Paul's. It is a perfect time for those of us who are new here to answer God's call to become more involved in this community. It is a perfect time for those of us who have been here for a long time. We can renew our commitments and find new ways to answer God. So think about this. Let's all think about this. Think about where our heart is leading us, where you have a yearning, where we might want to commit our time and talent. Pray, meditate about this, and see where the Spirit is leading you to answer God's call. Most calls are not as dramatic as a voice telling you directly what you must do. They're not that dramatic, but the effect on our lives and in the world can be that dramatic. I am so grateful for the lessons today. I am so grateful they allowed me to share a bit of myself with you and to encourage you to look for and answer God's call. I hope that we all, as in the words of Howard Thurman, will have the courage, fearlessness, and power to answer. Amen.
Amen. Every soul, some brightly burning. Thank you.